Welcome to this conversation about how startups and corporates collaborate. And I'm here today with Zach Westfield, the VP of IntelligNight, and Shireen Sakhani, the head of Maersk Growth. So let's just dive into it. So the first question is for both of you. And as we see more and more corporates creating these close links to the startup scenes, so maybe you can both of you start with telling us a little bit about how corporates are doing that. And maybe we can start with you, Zach.
Yeah, so I don't think there's any other option these days. I think that disruption really happens with startups. One of my mentors at Microsoft, a guy called Chi Lu, used to run online and office. He had this quote that he said, he told me, corporate innovation is dead. Corporate innovation is only going to come from startups and skunk works. Ooh. So I've been covering the startup side of corporate innovation for many, many years, both at Microsoft and now at Intel. Mm. And I think there's no other choice. I think that the world is moving so much faster and so much disruption is happening out there. And none of us big corporates, tech corporates, would have a chance without being open to that, to what's happening outside.
Yeah, no, very interesting. And Shireen, can you talk a little bit about the different ways that corporates are doing this and how particular you're doing it at Maersk Growth?
Yeah, it's as Zach says, I think it's a really exciting time where a lot of things are coming together. The pace of technology, the amazing innovation that's happening, and in our case, actually at Maersk, in particular, if we zoom in on supply chain, the crazy disruption that we've seen from COVID the last few years, which has really opened a lot of opportunities to interact with startups. And it depends a lot what is the goal and what you want to achieve. There are different innovation levers from corporate venture capital, being an investor and really partnering in a marriage sort of way for some years, to setting up a venture client unit where we work and experiment with startups, to actually accelerators as Intel is doing. And all the tools have pros and cons. It really depends what is your goal and objective and what you want to get out of this together with the startup.
Yeah,
I agree. I think they're very complementary. These tools are very complementary. Mm-hmm. The question is, what are you trying to optimize for?
Yeah.
I think each one of these tools optimizes for a very different outcome.
Yeah. And of course, you are running a deep tech accelerator. Can you talk a little bit more to why you're doing that and how you're doing it and what that solves for?
Sure. So again, the purpose of Ignite, like you asked before about corporates working with startups, was first of all to make Intel relevant for startups and for startups realize that we're relevant. Mm-hmm. So it's connecting to these disruptors. How do we build a program that's the best support infrastructure for founders that they would want to come to us, and then through that we could learn a lot of things. So example, we announced that we're building a cloud service, Dev Cloud, and five of our startups are actually design partners of Intel for our Dev Cloud, right? Not the other way around. Not that we're their design partners. They're our design partners. We're building the cloud service of the future.
Yeah.
So again, first thing is connecting as disruptors. The second is the learning, and the last thing is changing the culture of the company. And we're going to maybe talk about this a bit later. But when it comes to deep tech, startups are challenged, right? Mm-hmm. Deep tech usually takes a long time to develop, and it's very important to get your first customers or your first engagement with a real company. So imagine the amazing thing for these early stage startups that their first POC is with someone like Intel.
Yeah.
Right? That makes all your future funding so much easier, your future customer engagement so much easier, because you just went through the Intel security procurement, due diligence, super tough.
Mm-hmm.
So so for deep tech startups, really important. For us, it's not easy because it's not easy to evaluate early deep tech startups. Some of these things takes a long time to develop.
Yeah, I can definitely resonate with many of the points you say, Zach. It's really, there's a lot of investors out there who say we do deep tech, but then really when you get to it, it takes many years and a lot of money. And I really believe corporates have a great power and a great benefit to bring to the table here, because we can be early adopters and do POCs and do the offtakes early on. And for example, for us, it's about decarbonization. There, you know, whether it's our ships, very, very heavy assets that we need to find the new fuels for. So we're working with the green fuel startups who it takes a lot of money to build the first little factory to be able to produce, and we commit to the offtake for following years. So I really think corporates can play a significant role in the acceleration of innovation when it comes to like more asset heavy deep tech tactics. And also another issue deep tech startups tend to face is when it involves moving stuff, there's typically supply chain issues, right? I mean, it's not like a SaaS company that just builds online and so on. So so here as well, with our hopefully supply chain expertise, we can actually help them build the infrastructure around around how to do that. So corporates play an increasingly important role, I believe.
Yeah. Right, but if I can comment, it's so I agree with you, it's very important and corporates play an important role. But there's a big challenge. The culture of corporates sometimes is tough to engage with early stage startups.
That I completely agree with.
So the whole NIH, the whole, it's very hard to engage. So I think part of what we're trying to do is create that bridge, right? And we have about 250 people now from within the company that are part of our mentor network. Yeah. So what I mentioned, these intelpreneurs that are becoming that change agents from within and are much more open to work with outside companies. Mm. That's probably the biggest challenge to engage with mostly companies been around for a while and they're not really easy to engage with. So. Yeah.
And maybe you can deep dive on those or some of these main challenges. What do we basically see as the key difference between a young startup and then a big gorilla like Intel?
Oh, the differences are huge, right? First of all, young startups are amazing. The energy is amazing. They're willing to experiment, do many things. Their beauty in you being a founder multiple times, you know, what you do is never perfect. And it's if it's perfect, then it's too late. Yeah. So it's
iterate.
Yeah. So there's a lot of great things about this process. In corporates, we find it much harder to operate this way, right? Yeah. So this is where this culture. Clash between having everything sorted out, every answer answered, and then operate in this super agile fashion as a startup. So this is the culture clash between the two. We're trying to create these startups within the corporates. Yeah, not easy because it's not the same mindset.
Yeah. No.
But very big difference in the way they operate. I think that part of the value of what, for example, my program brings to Intel is this ability to think differently.
Yeah.
This permission for people to actually experiment more and exercise what does it mean to operate much faster. Because when they see these startups operating like crazy and iterating constantly, I think they get some of it and they want to take some of it internally.
Makes sense. And Shireen, of course, you are from a corporate venture capital, so a corporate investor. Can you elaborate a little bit on some of the differences? What is it that you get from a corporate investor like Maersk Growth versus a traditional financial investor?
Yeah, I think here it's really about the value that we bring post-investment.
Yeah.
We spoke about the deep tech element and the benefits corporate can bring. That's one of them. We actually made a list at Maersk Growth to sort of try to articulate the value, and it worked out really nicely in A, B, C, D, E.
Yeah.
So A is our assets. Mm-hmm. You know, we have ships and trucks and all these kind of things. So for IoT startups or deep tech startups, or like robotics for warehouses and so on. B is our brand, and like you were saying, Zach, you know, doing a POC with Intel or with Maersk, if you're in the supply chain space, means a lot. And C, which is perhaps the most important one of all, is customers.
Yeah.
We have now close to 97,000 customers, and even if we can get 20 of those to work with the startups in our portfolio, that's huge because we invest early stage. And building those customer connections and just the exchange of ideas and benefits. D is data, which is becoming increasingly important now. We have a view on 20% of global trade that we move, and we collect data in all parts of those operations and actually utilizing those. And last but not least, expertise of the 100,000 people, supply chain experts that we have at Maersk. And depending on the startup, we work together and see what is most relevant for them at that stage of maturity and so on. And we make those very cool value creation plans post-investment. And then we hold hands and try to make it happen. And like you say, Zach, I think, so at Maersk Growth, we have a team that specifically does that. We call them the human APIs. You know, they connect like the big Maersk with startups, and they speak startup and they speak corporate, so they can actually do that connection, because we've seen in the past it fails if you just introduce a startup to the corporate and like cross your fingers and hope it happens. It doesn't work that way. So these are real business development experts, senior guys and girls who do that, and then like project manage everything, and
I agree, that's the holy grail. For startups, that's the holy grail, right? Yeah. Everything, if you get them customers, this is the one thing they really want and appreciate. Everything else will fall in place. This is what they want. We try to do many other things for them, but if there's something that they really want, is this access to customers.
Yeah.
It's a big deal.
So maybe following up with that line of questions, so what are some of the key areas that you need to get right when you collaborate with startups? And maybe also what are some of the things you are not getting right yet, but basically you would like to improve in the future or get even better at to create value both ways?
Yes, I think part of the reason that most corporate innovation program with startups fail is because of the engagement model, right? And actually, there are three things that needs to happen for these programs to be successful.
Yeah.
One, it has to be staffed properly. So all of our programs, we work in pods. Every location, we have a pod. Yeah. Every pod is managed by a serial entrepreneur, someone that used to run a startup, sold that startup, hired, fired, went through the whole process. There's a CTO, a strong technical person. There's a deal flow manager, an ops manager. And then there's a value creation person that deals with the business side, right? So how it's staffed, it's critical.
Yeah.
In many cases, you have an old timer from the corporate that's been around. He knows everyone. He's going to work with the startups. Many times, not the right the right connection. Or you have a super smart MBA, super effective program manager, but again, lacks that what's important for startup piece, right? So how it's staffed is number one. The second is how it's funded. It's not a hobby. It has to be funded properly, and it has to have the right support infrastructure, and that's maybe the most important thing. Is this third thing is how is it sponsored? And when I used to be at Microsoft, I was running Microsoft for Startups, started by Satya, which I reported into the Cloud and Enterprise division before he became the CEO, and later Scott Guthrie that runs Azure, and Satya was a big support. And at Intel, I was hired by the former CEO of Intel. I report now to the CTO of Intel. It's really important to have that level of support. Otherwise, it becomes a marketing program or a CSR program. So these are critical, and without these things, I think there's very little chances of these programs to actually succeed and be around.
And are there any areas where you're still struggling, where you're still trying to find the right model, or where you need to innovate yourself to make this work?
Of course. We're in constant, I said, we're never a product market fit. We're constantly changing. The market is changing constantly. The company is changing constantly. This culture journey is an ongoing process, right? And we have 120,000 people at Intel. Similar size of company, right? It's not easy to move all these people. And again, many of them have been doing so successfully things for many years, and we ask them to change in some ways. That change is not easy. So we have a long way ahead of us of driving that change.
Yeah.
But we're in a great track so far.
Awesome.
So.
Yeah. And Shireen, same line of questions. Do you have any further input?
I was listening to Zach, and in my head I had almost the same points, but in a different order.
Yeah.
To me, like what you said, sponsor. We have to be super clear about the why.
Yeah.
Like, why are we here? How do we fit in the company strategy? What are we here to achieve? Because if that's not like crystal clear and aligned at the top, then honestly, it's going to be really hard to achieve the objectives then. So we've worked really hard to define Maersk Growth as part of the strategy on bringing external innovation into Maersk and articulating what good looks like some years down the line, right? So, and The second, which is maybe linked to this, is to have a long-term view. Because there is an inherent paradox between a corporate annual cycle and an engagement with a startup, especially if you invest early stage. This is a marriage, as I said, for 10, 12 years maybe. So it's really to understand that we have to work at different horizons and that we're in this for the long run, and to have that organizational and senior executive commitment to that. And then totally agree on competencies and having the right mix across. We have guys in the team who come from the VC world, like investment professionals, partners. We have founder, ex-founders, and we have corporates. And getting that culture to work actually is also quite an interesting. It's quite an interesting experience in itself. And then last but not least is really being super transparent with startups and very honest on what we can do and what we can't do. Because this is how it can go very wrong, by overpromising and not delivering.
Makes sense. Then maybe last question before we wrap up. Of course, we are in a current, should we say, financially and economic challenging market. We see funding dry up, geopolitical tension, inflation, and so on. Maybe you can elaborate a little bit on how that's impacting corporate innovation activities from an accelerator point of view, and also what maybe are some of the opportunities there are in such a market.
Sure. So, a few things. First of all, good startups are still getting funded. There's still funding for great companies. I think in times like this, having support infrastructure, like a strong corporate that could help you with mentorship, with connections, with business opportunities, is huge. Because especially in these times, revenues talk. Right? You need customers, you need people actually paying you for whatever you're selling, versus more, you know, funding and everything will be fine in the future.
They're not given the same leeway to experiment and take their time as in the past few years.
I agree. So you need to be a much more, you need to be much more effective in helping them. So I think in these times, even more than ever, it's really important to have these kind of programs supporting founders. And I think for us, that's a great opportunity also, because there's less noise in the market, and there are better opportunities.
And the same question to you, Shireen. So what is the role of a corporate investor in this challenging market? I guess, I mean, the same or sort of the problems we have in our business around decarbonization, digitizing global supply chain, they are not really going away.
No. And if anything, with the energy crisis in Europe and everything else that's going on, it even further accelerates the need to find solutions as fast as possible. So I think while the funding environment, and we've all seen what happened in the tech stock markets and so on, I completely agree with that, with Zach. The good startups, so we'll have fewer startups, but really good ones, and we will have an opportunity to partner closer than ever, I think. And for us, And for a corporate, the key thing is continuity, as I was also just mentioning long term, that this is not a bad season, so we change tack. We're still very much focused on our overall strategy, and we're focused on innovation and on working with these startups, and that will continue even in the current environment. And then I would say we have an ambitious transformation agenda, and I think the last few years have shown us, you know, the humility that we really can't do this alone. And as Zach started out saying, startups have a critical role to play in redrawing the future, most certainly of supply chain. So still on.
So I guess we are through all the questions. So thanks for a very interesting conversation. Really listening to how corporates create value for startups and vice versa. And then have a very great web summit for the rest of the week.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for having me.